All right. We're going to call to order the Monday, March 18th, 2024 meeting of the Tennessee Real Estate Appraiser Commission. I believe we need to start with a roll call.
Yes, sir. Taylor Van Dever.
Present.
Eric Robinson.
Here.
Brett Mansfield.
Here.
Francie Mello. He's absent today. Sandra Tupp.
Here.
Nelson Pratt.
Here.
Dr. Mark Sunderman.
Here.
And Will Haston.
Here.
Real quick, Chair, before we turn it over, just a reminder that the public comments portion, right before our legal report, those will be comments related to items from the agenda for any public that comes in either in person or on Teams. To keep comments also 2 to 3 minutes. All yours, Chair.
Excellent. And can you confirm we do have quorum?
Yes, sir, we have quorum.
Excellent. Okay. Has everybody had a chance to take a look at the agenda? Yes.
Yes.
Any recommendations or motions for approval?
Motion to approve.
I second it.
All right, agenda is approved. Moving on, the November minutes. We had a chance to review those. Any edits or comments? Motions?
Motion to approve.
We have a motion on the floor.
Second.
And a second. Motion carries.
Just all in favor.
Okay. Yep. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Motion carries. I believe we are ready then for the rulemaking hearing. I'll turn that over to legal.
Okay. This rulemaking hearing is called to order. My name is Anna Matlock. I serve as an Associate General Counsel in the Department of Commerce and Insurance, Division of Regulatory Boards, and I represent the Tennessee Real Estate Appraiser Commission. Would the agency representatives who are present introduce themselves for the record?
Heidi Overstreet, Administrative Manager.
Glenn Kopchick, Executive Director. Just have to work our way down.
Mark Sunderman, Member of the Board.
Eric Robinson,
Member of the Board.
Nelson Pratt, Member of the Board.
Brett Mansfield, Chair.
Sandra Tuck, Vice Chair.
Will Haston, Member of the Board.
Taylor Vandiver, Member of the Board.
Thank you. Today is Monday, March 18th, 2024. This rulemaking hearing is taking place pursuant to Tennessee Code Annotated 4-5-204. In bicentennial law conference room. All right, guys, hold on
while she's doing that, too, just a quick note. All votes for during a rulemaking hearing will be by roll call. So just for the record, so like when we get there, we'll just have to go down the list and hit everyone to memorialize that. And we'll return back to voice vote after that.
Just a yes or no.
Yes, that's correct.
Section 4-5-204 in Bicentennial Conference Room on the 11th floor of Casey Crockett Tower, 500 James Robertson Parkway, Nashville, Tennessee. And also available by electronic means via Microsoft Teams, which can be located on the program's website, www.tn.gov/redboard/TREAC/meetings.html. On this page, the link for access to the rulemaking hearing via Microsoft Teams can be found in the chart located on the middle of the webpage and the first row with the date 3/18/2024 in the location column under the words Davy Crockett Tower, 11th floor, Nashville, PN, labeled Connect. The purpose of this rulemaking hearing is to solicit comments on rule amendments to the rules and regulations of the Tennessee Real Estate Appraiser Commission. The proposed rule amendment updates the requirements for Tennessee for appraiser qualifications for AQB certified instructors of the Uniform Standards of Professional Appraisal Practice, ECAP, to include those instructors not only the state certified residential or state certified general, but also in good standing. Additionally, the education qualifications for state certified residential appraisers are clarified as it relates to a bachelor's degree requirements. Lastly, the registration application certification requirements for appraisal management companies, AMCs, are amended to remove the language more than 10% to align the rule with the statutory requirement that all persons on an AMC must certify that they have not been convicted of certain felony misdemeanors or had any disciplinary actions related to their license in any state. The proposed rule amendments are required following an audit from the appraisal subcommittee, ASC. A rule is defined as a general, as an agency statement of general applicability that implements a prescribed law or policy or describes the procedures or practice requirements of the agency. Proposed rules are filed with the Office of the Secretary of State. Notice is given to the public for comment and a rulemaking hearing is held. Upon conclusion of the hearing and adoption of the proposed rules, the rules are forwarded to the Attorney General's office for review of legality. If approved, they are filed with the Secretary of State, which is responsible for publication, and the Government Operations Committee of the General Assembly. The rules must stay in the Secretary of State's office for 90 days, of which time will be the effective date. Please listen carefully. Those members of the public wishing to speak and appearing in person should place their name on the sign-in sheet. Those members of the public wishing to speak and appearing via Microsoft Teams should raise their hand. Use the raise the hand function. Oral comments will be accepted by those who have written their name on the sign-in sheet and typed their name in the chat box will only be permitted to speak. Is there anyone that desires to offer oral comments but who has not written their name on the sign-in sheet or typed their name in the chat box? For those attending this hearing in person, we will have a copy of the rulemaking hearing notices shortly. Once they're provided, they will be placed on the podium, and you'll be able to find a red line copy of the rule amendments addressed in today's rulemaking hearing. The notice of rulemaking hearings included the entire text of the proposed rules and were published on the Tennessee Administrative Register website on January 16, 2024. Mr. Kotchak, what additional notice was given to the affected entity?
information for the time and location of the hearing was placed on the program's website, and an e-notify was sent to all licensees signed up for the program system on January 18th, 2024.
As the agency hears public comment on the proposed rules, I, as moderator, reserve the right to limit such comments if they become repetitive. Please limit your comments accordingly. First, I will summarize the substance of the proposed rules into the record. Rule 1255.01-0.05, qualifications for state license, paragraph 1B1I1, is amended by adding the language and good standing, so that as amended, the rule shall read, and we provide it there. Rule 1255.01-0.07, qualifications for state certified residential appraiser, paragraph 1B1I, is amended by adding the language and in good standing. Rule 1255.01-0.08, qualifications for general certification, paragraph 1I is amended by adding an S to subparagraph and adding the language or H, so or H. Rule 1255.02.05, C6, course guidelines, course content guidelines, qualifying education, paragraph 4C6 is amended by adding the language in good standing. Rule 1255.08.01, registration application requirements, paragraph 1G, is amended by deleting the text more than 10%. Mr. Kopchak, were any written comments received by the Commission Office for the rule amendments that were not forwarded to me prior to today's hearing?
No.
As I have not received any written comments received via email prior to the hearing, I will now solicit comments from individuals present at today's meeting, either in person or via Microsoft. Seeing that there are none, this will now conclude the comment period for the rulemaking for this rulemaking package. Lastly, there are several measures that I will need to read into the record as required by CCA Section 4-5-222. However, first I will need a motion to adopt the hearing rule language as presented.
So moved.
Second. All right, we have a motion from Chair Mansfield, a second from Mr. Van Dever. Roll call vote. Taylor Van Dever?
Yes.
Eric Robinson?
Yes.
Rhett Mansfield?
Yes.
Sandra Tuff?
Yes.
Nelson Pratt?
Yes.
Dr. Mark Sunderman?
Yes.
And Will Hasten?
Yes.
Thank you. That motion's passed.
Next, I will read the regulatory flexibility addendum. Pursuant to TCA Section 4-5-401 through 4-5-404, prior to initiating the rulemaking process, all agencies shall conduct the review of whether a proposed rule or rule affects small business. The type or types of small businesses and an identification and estimate of the number of small businesses subject to the rule being proposed that would bear the cost of or directly benefit from the rule being proposed. The Commission does not anticipate the rule amendments to directly impact small businesses. Requiring AQB certified USTAP instructors to be in good standing, requiring certified residential appraisers to have a bachelor's degree or higher, and clarifying AMC registration or certification requirements will not subject small businesses to additional costs as each update and amendment impacts the affected licensees individually. Therefore, the cost of any are not borne by small businesses. To the extent the requirements that requiring a bachelor's degree or higher may indirectly increase costs to hire such appraisers, the Commission lacks information in estimating the increase to cost. However, this requirement is necessary to comply with APB criteria. The projected reporting, record keeping, and other administrative costs required for compliance with the rule being proposed, including the type of professional skills necessary for preparation of the report or record. The commission does not foresee a cost for the administration and enforcement of these rule amendments. A statement of the probable effects on impacted businesses and consumers. The commission does not anticipate the rule to directly impact small businesses, as these rule amendments apply to the impacted licensees on an individual basis. Small business will not incur any cost. The commission does not foresee an impact on consumers because of the rule amendment. A description of any less burdensome, less intrusive, or less costly alternative methods of achieving the purpose and objectives of the rule being proposed that may exist, and to what extent the alternative means might be less burdensome to small business. The commission knows of no other less restrictive or burdensome means than through the promulgation of these rules as amended. A comparison of the rule being proposed with any federal or state counterparts. All states that are regulated by the ASB have rules like the rules promulgated. Analysis of the effects of the possible exemption of small businesses from all or any part of the requirements contained in the rule being proposed. The commission does not anticipate the rule to directly impact small businesses. All rule amendments affect the impacted licensees individually and are specific to the real estate appraiser industry. Therefore, an exemption for small businesses would not be beneficial. I will now need a motion to adopt the regulatory flexibility addendum.
So moved.
Second.
Got a motion from Chair Mansfield. Got a second from Mr. Pratt. Roll call vote. Taylor Van Dever.
Yes.
Eric Robinson.
Yes.
Brett Mansfield.
Yes.
Sandra Tuck.
Yes.
Nelson Pratt.
Yes.
Dr. Mark Sunderman.
Yes.
And Will Haston.
Yes.
I will now read the impact on local government statement pursuant to TCA Section 4-5-68. The Tennessee Real Estate Appraiser Commission foresees no impact on any local government. I will now need a motion to adopt the impact on local government statement.
So moved. Second.
Got a motion from Chair Mansfield to adopt that robust statement. And we've got a second from William Haston. Roll call vote. Taylor Van Dever.
Yes.
Eric Robinson.
Yes.
Brett Mansfield.
Yes.
Sandra Tuck.
Yes.
Nelson Pratt.
Yes.
Dr. Mark Sunderman.
Yes.
And Will Haston.
Yes.
I will now read the answers to the questions required by the Joint Government Operations Committee. All agencies, upon filing a rule, must submit the following pursuant to TCA Section 4-5-226(I)(1). A, a brief summary of the rule and description of all relevant changes and previous regulations effectuated by such rule. The proposed rule amendments update the requirements for the Appraisal Qualification Board, AQB, certified instructors of Uniform Standards of Professional Appraisal Practice, UPAP, to include that those instructors not only be state-certified, residential, or state-certified general, but also in good standing. Additionally, the education qualifications for state-certified residential appraisers are updated to require a bachelor's degree or higher. Lastly, the registration application certification requirements for appraisal management companies, AMCs, are amended to remove the language more than 10% to align the rule with the statutory requirement that all persons that own an AMC must certify they have not been convicted of certain felonies, misdemeanors, or had any negative disciplinary actions related to their license in any state. The proposed rule amendments are required following an audit from the appraisal subcommittee, ASP. B, a citation to a brief description of any federal law or regulation or any state law or regulation mandating promulgation of such rule or establishing guidelines relevant thereto. Title 11 of the Financial Institutions Reform, Recovery, and Enforcement Act of 1989, FERIA, requires appraisers performing assignments in federally regulated transactions meet qualifications set by the AQB and the AFC. C, identification of persons, organizations, corporations, or government entities most directly affected by the rule, and whether those persons, organizations, corporations, or governmental entities urge adoption or rejection of the rule. The rule would affect current and future licensees and applicants. The commission anticipates members of the industry to be proponents of the rule amendments, as the rules are required to federal compliance with existing uniform regulations for real estate appraisers. The commission does not foresee a particular segment of opponents to these rules. C, identification of any opinions of the Attorney General and reporters for any judicial ruling that directly relates to the rule or necessity to promulgate the rule. There are no known opinions of the Attorney General and Reporter for any judicial ruling that directly relate to this rule. E, an estimate of the probable increase or decrease in state and local government revenues and expenditures, if any, resulting from the promulgation of this rule, and assumptions and reasoning upon which the estimate is based. An agency shall not state the fiscal impact is minimal if the fiscal impact is more than 2% of the agency's annual budget or $500,000, whichever is less. There is no foreseeable probable increase or decrease in state and local government revenues and expenditures resulting from the promulgation of this rule. F, identification of the appropriate representative or representatives possessing a substantial knowledge and understanding of the rule. That would be Anna Matlock and Glenn Hotchat. G is identification of the persons that will explain the rule at the scheduled meeting of the committees. Again, that's Anna Matlock and Glenn Hotchat. H, office address, telephone number, email address. I'm not going to read through that. And then I, any additional information relevant to the rule proposed for continuation that the committee requests. There is no known additional relevant information. I will now need a motion to adopt the additional information for the Joint Government Operations Committee.
So moved.
Second.
And a motion from Chair Mansfield, a second from Vice Chair Tuck. Roll call vote, Taylor Van Dever.
Yes.
Eric Robinson.
Yes.
Brett Mansfield.
Yes.
Sandra Tuck.
Yes.
Nelson Pratt.
Yes.
Dr. Mark Sunderman.
Yes.
Will Haston.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. I would now like just one last call to see if there are any individuals present or on scene that would like to make a comment related to the rulemaking hearing. That concludes this rulemaking hearing. Following this hearing, the rules will be put on rulemaking filing form SS-7039, submitted to the Governor's Office for final review, and then submitted to the Attorney General's Office for review and approval. Once the Attorney General's signature is obtained, deed are filed with the Secretary of State and generally become effective 90 days from the date of filing after receiving a positive recommendation from the Joint Government Operations Committee. Thank you for being here today. This concludes the rulemaking hearing.
Thank you.
Brief recess?
Yeah, that sounds okay. Good. 10 minutes?
Yeah, that sounds perfect.
So we'll reconvene at 9:35. All right. We've concluded the rulemaking hearing. I think we're ready for the experience interviews.
Yes, sir. Do you want me to read them off?
Yes.
Go ahead.
Please.
Okay. We'll start with Mr. William Payson. We have Daniel Easterly for Upgrade CR. Still recommend yes?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Brett Mansfield. You have Valerie Clark, Upgrade to CG. Still recommend yes?
Yes.
And then for Ms. Francie Mello, she recorded yes and yes for Brandy. I'm not going to attempt the last name. I do not want to butcher it, but Upgrade to CR. Patrick Finkley, Upgrade to CR. And we got an email after I had sent you all this agenda last week. She did recommend yes for Nathan Carter for Upgrade to CR. Mr. Nelson Pratt, we have Anthony Eaton and Caitlin Page, Upgrade to CR. Sarah Vaughn for License. And Nicholas Lesser for Upgrade to CG. Is that all yeses still?
Yes.
Is Andrew Tuck. We have Trent Waltney and Roger Richardson for CR. Both still yes, ma'am?
Yes.
Thank you. And Mr. Taylor Van Dever, Emily Potts for CR. Do you need yes, no, or defer?
Defer for now. We've got new information to recover.
Yes, sir. Okay.
All right. Do we have a motion to approve the experience interviews?
Motion to approve.
Have a motion?
Second.
Motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, motion carries. Moving on, we are ready for the education report.
You can see that I had a list of different courses I reviewed. In general, I just would like to make the comment, I've been very impressed with the quality of the courses I've reviewed. I've been very impressed with them. I've made the comment, I wish I had time to take them all. I'd like to make the recommendation that they all be approved.
All right. The recommendation?
Sir,
okay. Did we have a motion on the floor? Do we have a second?
Second.
Any comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? All right. Motion carries. All right. Now we are ready for the director's report.
Yep. All right. We're going on to the budget. You can open up that portion. We're going to be looking over the month of October to January. We're going to look at the overall surplus and deficit so far for our fiscal year. We can look under the revenues. If you scroll over to the right, we are currently at a surplus of, we had a surplus of $484,000. And going down that column into the deficit, it was $347,000. And that left us with a net of $137,000. So like last time, we have a healthy balance and we're looking good in terms of surplus and deficit. I did want to bring your attention to the columns for November and December, and they're under our expenses, Edison expenditure totals, particularly the ones marked other, and I highlighted them in green. You'll see November has a deficit of $24,000, and then January has a deficit of $22,000. And what those are ASC and AMC registry fees. So those are normal expenses. I wanted to point those out because those numbers kind of jump out at you. And if you recall from our last board meeting in December, I had noted the $16,000 expense in September, and I would let you know I would look into it. And that is the same. It was a payment to FFIEC Appraisal Subcommittee, another registry fee. So I just wanted to provide you that, like I said I would. So those are the most significant things that stood out on the report. And like I said, everything's balanced and looking good. If you guys have any questions, let me know. Right. Good. Next item on the director's report is the Aero Conference. We have two coming up. We have a local one that is going to be hosted here in Nashville, May 3rd to the 5th, that's Friday through Sunday. And then the second conference is in fall, October 28th to the 30th, that's a Monday through Wednesday. And that's up in the best area in New England, in Boston, so where the greatest sports team come out of. So you know.
Yeah.
And you can actually announce it.
What was the date?
The fall one, sir, is October 28th to the 30th. That's a Monday through Wednesday. Mm-hmm. So right now for the local, Brett, I believe you said you were available, and maybe Ms. Tuck. Uh-huh. And Will, possibly. Mm-hmm. Is there anyone else that is available? Okay. I know they did mention for that weekend for hotels to move on them. We do have a major event that weekend. Concerts and stuff like that. And
are we going to
keep you and I on that? Okay.
Are we able to send three?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah. They're local, we can do that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. For me, so I mean, I'm in town, so no hotel food or anything like that. So.
Okay. Do we have a motion to send Will Hasten, Sandra Tuck, and Brett Mansfield to the Spring Aero Conference in May?
I'll make a motion for that.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
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 Any opposed? It's unanimous voice vote. And then fall conference. Would anyone like to go to the great city of Boston?
I'll go if nobody else is going.
Okay. We can have three and then an alternate for that.
I'd like to check my schedule, but I potentially would be interested.
And as an alternate, maybe?
Potentially.
Okay.
And so we'll have another meeting between now and then,
yeah,
too, correct? So
yes,
maybe we can check schedules and can
we
come.
Want to defer that one?
Yeah. Yeah.
So would you like to defer that, Chair?
I think so. I think everybody can check their schedule, and maybe we can come back to that.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. That's all I have, Chair.
Okay. It concludes the director's report. we have a public comment period related to items on the agenda before we get to the legal. Is there any public comments? Okay. All right, hearing none, we'll move on to the legal report.
Hey, morning, everybody. Pretty short legal report today. Not to make complaints, just a comment report. But before I get into any of them, are there any that you want to discuss first or any you want to group together?
I don't think so. There being four. Yeah, I think so.
Okay.
Let's do buddy. Okay. Yeah, let's go through all of them.
Okay. Number one is 2023-063901. And this complainant was alleging respondent trespassed onto their property and drove past their gate. respondent states that they were only entered the property to confirm comparable information they found at MLS. The police were called. No action was brought, and they found that there were no laws violated. So I was recommending that this be dismissed without any action.
Make a motion to dismiss.
Second.
Okay, we've got a motion and a second. Is there any comment? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, motion carries.
Number two is 2024-000851. In this complaint, it was a levy respondent was attempting to pressure complainant to change the value of their revision request. Respondent denied the allegations. Respondent did provide the comments they made to complainant during the revision process, and I reviewed them, and I did not believe that they were trying to pressure complainant to change the value. It just looked like they were making some requests to change on the report. As such, I was recommending dismissing this without any action.
So this was an appraisal management company,
yes.
Correct?
Is the respondent, yes.
So an appraiser made the complaint.
Yes. And they were alleging that respondent was attempting to pressure them to change the value within their report, but they provided all the comments and all the communication between them and the complainant. I didn't believe that there was any attempt at pressuring them to change the value.
Motion to dismiss.
Second.
All right, we've got a motion and a second. Any further comments or discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
Okay. The next one is 2023-057001. In this complaint, it was alleging respondent was negligent in their knowledge of the comparables in subject property neighborhood. They allege that sufficient comparables were sent to respondent, but that respondent refused to utilize them. They also allege that respondent was unprofessional and failed to answer any inquiries. Respondent states that they originally had this appraisal ordered on September 13, 2023. It was canceled on September 18, 2023, and then reinstated on October 5, 2023. They explained that they were told that the home was vacant and that they could access it on their own schedule via a key box. They say on October 19th, they invoked Tidewater about 10 days after the inspection. They said that this could be a little bit longer than typical because they were trying to locate additional comparables in the neighborhood. Respondent notes that three of the original comparables were the same ones the realtor sent after Tidewater was invoked. They said they refused the sales and made the required adjustments. They said they apologized for any mistakes they may have made, but they believe that they used the best information available to support their conclusion. They also note that they communicated with both the lender and mortgage company throughout the entire process. An expert review was conducted. The reviewer notes that items found below were minor issues and that none of the items caused the overall report to be misleading or not meaningful. They found the filing violation. Number the first one was a record-keeping rule violation. They note that respondent's work file was provided and included 7 pages of handwritten notes. And that the following items are not located in the work file. Did not include a true copy of the written report. So there's no signed and dated appraisal certification. And there are only a few references to the location of the MLS data. Second violation they found was the standard 1, 5AB, and standard 2X. They found the appraiser did not analyze the contract or prior sale. And the final violation they found was 21A, which was the property was noted as the owner occupied in the report when the property was actually vacant. And this person does have, I could discuss because even though the reviewer said that there were minor issues found, they do have quite a bit of history. So I can go into that history of what we have information on the older ones, but we have kind of what the conclusion of them was. In 2013, the respondent signed a consent order for to pay $500 civil penalty and to take a report writing course. In 2014, they did $1,000 civil penalty and a 15-hour report writing course. In 2016, they did a 7-hour supervisor course. and in 2021 to pay a $2,000 penalty, 30 hours of a sales comparison course, and a 14-hour report writing course.
Did you say a $2,000 penalty?
In 2021, yes.
It doesn't seem like we've got the attention yet. So you said in 2021 it was a USPAP class?
It was. 2021 was a $2,000 penalty, a 30-hour sales comparison course, and a 14-hour report writing course.
Report writing.
And did you say that in 2013 this appraiser had a report writing?
A report writing course and a $500.
The two report writing courses.
Three. In 2014, it was a 15-hour report writing course.
Did we ever look into the classes that at Aero that they offered in addition?
We did start to look into them, and so I can look into those more and see if there's any courses that
maybe. Yeah, I mean, it seems like we've prescribed every course that would, you know, I don't know if there's something else that.
Yeah, and I wasn't sure if, based on the violations that were kind of, there was a course that maybe you guys had in mind, or if there's something you wanted to do more, or if you didn't want to release the documents, just sort of expert notice that they were minor issues. So I wanted to just kind of get your guys' take on that.
Well, I notice here it says it did not include a true copy of the written report. Would that not have been saved in their computer? I don't understand how you could not have that.
I don't have the answer to that.
Because it is allowable to save it in your computer.
We it took quite some time to get the work file from them. We had to ask numerous times, and then the exit reviewer also requested it. So all we received from them was 7 pages of a handwritten note. And then the complainant, I believe Tara Wright, sends us the appraisal, not the respondent.
Correct.
That is all we can get from them. And that's what we provided to the reviewer. So that's what the reviewer noted.
Well, this was obviously a VA appraiser. But since they didn't analyze the contract, so that would have been blank in the appraisal. Because there's a place in there where it asks you to summarize the contract. So I don't understand how it would have gone through without that.
That's all the reviewer wrote under that was the appraiser did not analyze the contract with her. So that's all they included within the review.
A refinance because it's contract or prior sale. Assuming that.
So
I have the course
list
up,
I think,
that
well, of the
Aero
courses.
Can you read those?
Yeah, there are some courses specifically for report writing.
So I'll just read each one.
Sure.
There's an appraiser self-protection documentation and record keeping course. There's a report certification, what am I signing and why. There's a residential report writing versus form filing course. There's a scope of work, appraisals, and inspections. There's an assignment, conditions, elements, and results. There's a missing explanations course, and then there's a sales comparison approach course and an ethics, competency, and negligence course.
And those are all continuing ed?
Correct. No, sorry, the corrective education.
Corrective education. And do you have to take an exam at the end of this?
I think so, yeah. And then none of them are both towards your CPA department.
Did he, what are the past courses he took?
Sorry, and it says each of these courses require costing.
Were the past courses that he took corrective?
No, they were.
The corrective education courses is something fairly new, I believe,
yes.
With only within the last year. So, to my knowledge, the commission has never assigned any of these courses
yes,
to an appraiser.
My knowledge is.
And that's within our powers to do so?
Yes.
Yeah. It's just any of the courses that we typically would prescribe have already been prescribed here.
Yeah, this
so.
Is kind of like a new avenue.
These courses are specifically written for appraisers with issues that need to be corrected.
Yeah, so for those who want to get their careers back on track.
So this would be a different route than what we've
It would be education, but just different classes, maybe more specific to
the class have a fee that has to be paid by the.
Yeah, these are through McKissick, I believe, so there is a table I have to pay a fee to take the class.
Yeah, it looks like they're about three.
Does it say the hours? How long?
No, they're all 4 hours.
All 4 hours?
You know, reading between the lines, it looks like to me that there was a problem with, because the appraisal did not probably come in at the value.
Yes.
And I'm wondering if that's why there was the complaint, more so than these minor items.
Yeah, I can't comment on that because the complainant just noted that they responded to the complaint due to, they believe the respondent was negligent in their knowledge of comparable.
In other words, they didn't come in at the value, so
they were upset.
Yeah, so they were upset, yeah. Because if you invoke Tidewater, it's because you want to have more comps considered.
I think the lapse in time as well is probably a pretty big issue from the complainant's side of things. I'm not sure. I would recommend that he, this is not a motion, this is just for discussion, take whatever corrective course that we deem appropriate in order for him to have to pass an exam and actually have to pay attention this time. And I say he, I mean he or she.
Particularly as it relates to record keeping. Can you read off the one again that's about record keeping specifically?
Appraisal, self-protection, documentation, and record keeping.
Seems like that definitely needs to be part of it with not having
I feel like
full
based on the information we have, that was probably
part.
The biggest issue and
yeah.
That was probably the hardest thing to get.
So the way the corrective courses are written is you can assign either one or one through all of the courses you assign as necessary for the appraiser, depending on which areas they need corrective action in.
By recommending a course, would that be something that attaches to the record, like this previous stream?
Yes.
The only thing I'm struggling with, it seems like to me that because of the complaint, I'm not sure he's guilty of what's in the complaint. I think what happened is because of the complaint, he was looked at and we found these other issues that obviously need to be corrected. And because of his past record, they were never really addressed appropriately. So obviously there's a problem with this individual and how he or she is performing their tasks as an appraiser. It's unfortunate how we can somehow or another disconnect the two, because I don't feel he or she is guilty of what this complaint is charging this appraiser of doing. But indirectly because of that, other issues were discovered. So however we handle this, I'd like if we can somehow or another disconnect the two. Because I don't want the appraiser to feel that he or she is being punished for this claim that I don't feel they're really guilty for.
Certainly.
If that makes sense.
One option you have is a letter of instruction, which is non-disciplinary in nature, which tells them, hey, these are the problems, and this could be the result to include additional education should, you know, this be repeated. And that letter does go on their record internally. It's not disciplinary action, so they don't get deemed for it on the registry. However, we know about it, and then we could provide that as an aggravating factor for sentencing should we get another complaint.
Maybe legal can speak to it, but I would think that most of the complaints come from valuation, and then they're all subject to some. To
yeah, average. I would say a lot of complaints that come in are based off of one thing, then they get a review, and the things that come back are opposite or different. And in the consent, let's say you guys want the consent order and you assess a course, I would note this is what the expert so they would know the reason you're getting any kind of action taken against you is because the expert found this rule-keeping violation. This violation.
I just think based on the prior history that there is needed some sort of education. And so I'll go ahead and make a motion that we assess the corrective education class.
There was, can you name the specific class? Yeah. Record keeping?
So the first one is appraiser self-protection, documentation, and record keeping. Then report certifications, what am I signing and why? Then residential report writing versus form filling. Then scope of work, appraisals and inspections. Then assignments, conditions, elements, and results. Missing explanations, sales comparison approach, and ethics, competency, and negligence.
Okay. I mean, a lot of those would fit the bill. I mean, is there any?
I would think the first one, the record keeping.
I would like the, I mean, this is just my suggestion, but the course that was the report writing and why my checking boxes, or I'm not sure what you form filling.
Residential report writing versus form filling. And then, and the other one is report certifications. What am I signing and why?
Yeah. I like the form filling one as too. And so you said they're 4 hours each, right? Yes. Okay, so I'll make the motion that we, the first one, and then the form filling. So two of those corrective.
The documentation.
Yes.
And record keeping, and then the residential report writing versus form filling.
Yes. So that would be 8 total hours.
Have I disclosed, like, talked about my dead body analogy for you guys? Related to complaints. It sounds, okay, it sounds really controversial. But it was something I was brought up before. So when we receive a complaint, it may be related to one matter, but then we find other issues. So the analogy that I use is if you call the police for someone because someone has broken into your house and it's like a theft, but the police get there and they also find a dead body, they're not going to ignore that, right? If that's not going to be something that happens. So sometimes someone may file a complaint related to one issue, but then we do find other problems, and so that is still considered matters that we can look at. See, it's not as bad as I
thought. Okay. Well, I'll make that motion. So there's a motion on the floor.
I'll second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, motion carries.
Okay, then the final one is free presentation. It is 2023-023-841. This is the one that about 2 meetings ago, I believe. And in it, the complainant was alleging the respondent was having an unlicensed person perform their appraisal review for them. Basically, the complainant did not provide any evidence of this, and respondent denied it. So you guys have voted to have to go out for an investigation. An investigator spoke with both the complainant, who was not the employee involved within the complaint that was the alleged unlicensed employee that was creating the work. They were representing that employee in a previous whistleblowing case. They were unable to sufficiently bring that case, and so that was dismissed, and they filed this complaint. However, both the complainant and that employee expressed to the investigator that they had no desire to participate or provide any more information past the filing of the complaint. So I was recommending this complaint.
Okay.
Okay.
So it really didn't gain any new information.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
They seconded what they said in the complaint, but it basically the attorney stated that it didn't feel it would be appropriate to get involved anymore and would not want to be involved in a hearing or anything of that. And the employee basically said that they were not the one that filed the complaint and they did not want to be involved.
Who typically does the investigation?
We have a group of investigators that do it.
Got it.
Yeah, they work with the different commissions.
Got it.
Any comments? Discussion?
Seems to me if they both have no desire to participate moving forward, that we take legal advice and dismiss.
Is that in the form of a motion?
That is a motion.
Second. A motion and a second. Any comments? Discussion? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries.
That is it for the legal report.
All right. Up next New business. Open the floor. Is there any new business? Hearing none, we'll move on. Next up is adjournment.
You don't need a motion, Chair.
Don't need a motion?
You can just call it. It's like
that. All right, so this meeting is now adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you.